Good morning. We welcome all of you here today with us in person, all those joining us online. And as we begin our service, if we stand, we're going to sing "We Bring the Sacrifice of Praise."
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning grateful for the day you've blessed us with. Lord, we're grateful for your provisions. Lord, we just ask that our praise and worship be worthy in your sight this morning. Lord, we ask that you be with those who couldn't be with us this morning. Also, be with our sick. Be with those who have lost loved ones this week. Know we're most grateful for salvation. Through the Holy Spirit, continue to work and move in our lives, Lord. And again, we love you and we praise you and we give you all the glory. It's in Yeshua's name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Yeah. Good morning, everyone. We are so glad that you are here to worship with us this morning. Right now, let's take a few moments and talk about any additions or updates or praises that we have this morning. Jeff. Yeah. So Dan Clark, we've been praying for him for a while. His wife, Linda, is in the hospital, and they've discovered she has cancer as well. So I'll be praying for her and her upcoming treatments for Linda. Yes.
A couple praises. I want to tell everyone thank you that bought desserts or worked at the Village Bazaars on Friday. It was really great. A lot of people. Maybe not as many as last year, but still, we had a good turnout, and all the food was so appreciated, so thank you. And on Sandy, the surgery went well. Now she just behaves, but she will be in a sling for about 4 weeks. She can take it out of the sling about 3 times a day for 10 minutes and kind of rock her body gently. She can't move her shoulder, but she can kind of move the body to make it move a little. She goes back to the doctor this next week, so... But I appreciate all the prayers for her as well.
Huge praise for her surgery.
She's slinking for God.
Pat. Okay, so please pray for Lee Behan and her continuing ongoing pain in her back. Sandy. Pray for Rose on the infection that she has. Okay, yeah, absolutely. Mona? Absolutely. Yeah, sure, go ahead.
I got this, but it's a bookmark. It says, I am America's heritage. I am your flag. I was born on June 14th, 1777. I am more than just cloth shaped into a design. I am the refuge of the world's oppressed people. I am the silent sentinel of freedom. I am the emblem of the greatest sovereign nation on earth. I am the inspiration for which American patriots gave their lives and fortunes. I have led your sons into battle from Valley Forge to the bloody ridges of Korea. I walk in silence with each of you, honored dead, to their final resting place beneath the silent white crosses, row upon row. I have flown through peace and war, strife and prosperity. And amidst it all, I have been respected. My red stripes symbolize the blood spilled in defense of the glorious nation. My white stripes signify the burning tears shed by Americans who lost their sons. My blue field is indicative of God's heaven under which I fly. My stars cluster together, unify 50 states as one. For God and country. Old Glory is my nickname, and proudly I wave on high. Honor me, respect me, defend me with your lives and your fortunes. Never let my enemies tear me down from my lofty position, lest I never return. Keep alight the fires of patriotism. Strive earnestly for the spirit of democracy. Worship eternal God and keep his commandments, and I shall remain the bulwark of peace and freedom for all mankind. I am your flag.
What a great remembrance of Veterans Day. Nita? You say he went to the village? Is that where he's? All right. Kimmy?
My cousin Austin, this little boy Colton's at Colton Ballard. He's 2 months old. He went to Riley this past week for RSV. He did get to come home over the weekend, but please pray for him to continue to recover from RSV and get better. And then my second one is it's National Shoebox Collection Week, so please pray for every shoebox that comes in this building for all week long and for me to stay calm.
Master.
Just a continuous praise and blessing for this church. I brought three small children this morning with me, and they all call me Grandpa, even though they may not be any biological tie. But they look forward to this, every opportunity that they can. I thank this church so much for that opportunity that they're giving to these young children, and I hope this continues forever. Amen.
Yes.
So since Kenny talked about RSV, it's your yearly reminder for your nurse practitioner. Get your flu shot. If you're 60 and above, you qualify for an RSV vaccine. That's protecting yourself, but it's protecting these babies that need their protection. And most importantly, do not kiss the babies. So flu shot, RSV shot, and you can get those at your local pharmacy, and do not kiss the babies.
No matter how cute they are, right? Yeah. Mm-hmm. Keep praying for him as he's continuing to improve, but slowly. Good. Yeah. Good. Angie?
Lynn and I are having a boy. And his name will be Landon Paul.
Well, congratulations. Are any veterans in here? One in the restroom, okay. John, you can tell him the thanks for us. Okay. Yes. Yes, be praying for Michael. He was roughhousing with Miles this week, and in roughhousing, Michael got injured a little bit, and he's been having a lot of difficulty since then. So just keep Michael in your prayers this coming up week. All right. If there's nothing else, then let's go to the Lord in prayer at this time. Father God, we are just so grateful. Father, we're so grateful this morning for our church family that's here this morning, the church family that we worship with every week. Father, we're so grateful that we're able to grow together as a church body. And Father, we thank you for all the blessings that you've given to this church body. We thank you for the times that we've seen you and your hand at work, and that we can have no doubts that it was you, Father. Father, for the prayer requests that have been mentioned this morning, you know each situation better than we ever could. So, Father, we pray for each situation individually. And, Father, we ask that you would be present in every situation, and that you would provide whatever is needed. Father, on this day, we are thankful for our veterans. We're thankful for the sacrifice that they made. We're thankful that they're here still doing your work here on this earth. And Father, as we continue through this worship service, I ask that you would be with each and every one of us, that your spirit would touch each and every one of us this morning. We thank you, Father, for all that you do for us each and every day. And it's in your Son, Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
I don't know if you're like me, but sometimes you get in a mode where you're just singing the words because you've sung them all your life. And so as we sing, Must Jesus Bear the Cross Alone, think about the words as you're singing them. Because even more important now across the world with all the chaos, with Israel, it's just a mess. As we continue to send military around the world, it's even more important that we also remember that we're Americans and be proud of being Americans. So, must Jesus bear the cross alone.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Well, I don't know how long ago, maybe a month ago, Hunter and I were sitting down and been thinking about certain things, and We sometimes like taking the words of a familiar song and rewrite the song in a way that will give God the glory. So Hunter and I both changed the words of a familiar song and change it to where it's a song now about God's love for you, that you are always on God's mind.
That's okay. We'll just go ahead and do it.
All right, here.
Let's see. We'll try a different way here.
Yeah, here.
You ready? Maybe you didn't see me all the times I carry you, and maybe you didn't know me, how much I loved you. Little things I said and done for you, you did not even notice me. You're always on my mind. You're always on my mind.
Maybe you didn't know I held you all those lonely, lonely times. And I guess you didn't know that I am so happy that you're mine. If you ever felt second best, you were always my first love.
You're always on my mind. You're always on my mind.
Tell me how my sweet love died for you. Give me your heart to keep you satisfied, to keep you satisfied.
Little things I've said and done for you, I always took the time.
You're always on my mind. You're always on my mind. You're always on my mind. You're always on my mind.
That was a collaboration of writing the words of that with Hunter as well, and if we're thinking about that song, that you are always on God's mind. When Jesus was on the cross, and he was looking at all the people around him, and he said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they do." It was something that his heavenly Father was looking at for all people of all generations, because in that moment of sacrifice, God's love was so poured out for everyone, because you have always been on God's mind. About 2 weeks ago, there was a lady at the nursing home, and she was re-experiencing the death of her husband all over again. For her, it was like it just happened that day, and she was grieving so hard that I was trying to console her, and I just couldn't really console her very much because she was re-experiencing that all over again. And so I asked her to just come and try to refocus on worshiping God and coming to a worship service. And as she was there, she sat down by another lady who just lost her husband. I don't call that a coincidence, I call it a God incident. And she began to tell this other woman about the loss of her husband. That was actually 6 months ago, but for her, it was right then. And the other woman said, "I just lost my husband 2 weeks ago." She says, "I know he's in a better place." And she grabbed her hand, and they held hands together for the whole service. And I thought that was just such a beautiful picture about God's love between those two grieving women, because God is always has each one of us on his mind. I took a homeless man to a shelter this week. He was struggling a lot of different ways, but he was very appreciative of people who he knows has prayed for them, him, and Christians have helped him in the past, and coming to a deeper understanding that, yes, God loves him, that he is on God's mind. And this morning, Filonia Christian Church, as we partake of Holy Communion together, just realize as you partake of the body and the bread, that you are always on God's mind. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, you are so amazing in your love and mercy and grace that continues forever and ever for every one of us. So Lord, right now we ask you to bless the bread, the body of Christ, the people of God everywhere, every nation, every tongue, every nationality. And Lord, that you would bless the cup, that we would seek your heart and your forgiveness and seek your face, O Lord, during this time. As we come together as the body of Christ in Holy Communion, as we think about you in this holy moment, we thank you, Lord, because you think about us all the time. We give you praise and thanksgiving. In Jesus' name, amen.
When you think of Thanksgiving, is this what you think of? When I think of Thanksgiving, this is what I imagine. I remember being a little older than Noah, making the trip to my grandparents' house. My grandparents that lived in Lexington, Kentucky. We lived either in Hammond or Indiana, or we lived in Trenton, Ohio. I can't remember. But I remember the first year we went there that I can remember. I remember thinking about how, as a little kid, how dumb things are, you know? How dumb it is to go there just to eat, and you talk about why you're thankful, and then you get to eat good food, and then you sit around and you talk, and it wasn't fun. Wasn't fun for a five-year-old, necessarily. Didn't have iPads back then. Didn't have things to go take to keep your attention. You had to actually go outside and play. But this is what I think of when I think of Thanksgiving. When I think of this time of year, as the leaves turn, as we start bringing out the flannels, you know, I'm excited. You know, I get really excited nowadays because I want to have Thanksgiving. I want to gather together. And I'm against everybody decorating for Christmas until after Thanksgiving Day. I'll take my stance now, and I'll take whatever's coming to me. Let the turkey have his day. So as we're entering into this Thanksgiving season, as I think about Thanksgiving, this is what I think about. I think about everybody getting dressed up and sitting down and talking about what we're thankful for, being just thankful that we're all together, eating good food, obviously. Anytime we're together, we eat good food. But I enjoy the being together. It's funny how my priorities have changed over the years, isn't it? My priorities have changed. So we enter into talking about thankfulness, Thanksgiving, because that's what we do this time of year, right? That's what society does. That's what we do. It's a time where we get to set aside to remember to be thankful, right? To remember to be thankful for all that we have, to be thankful for our families, and the list can keep going on, and we could be here all day talking about what we're thankful for, right? We're going to talk about that today, about being thankful. And as I talk about being thankful or giving thanks, there was a couple scriptures that stuck out to me. The first scripture that stuck out to me was Psalm 100, verse 4. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name. If you've not spent a lot of time in the Psalms, you know that David, in a lot of the Psalms that he does, he talks about giving thanks, giving thanks, giving thanks. But this stands out to me every time. Give thanks, enter his gates with thanksgiving, and enter his courts with praise. The second verse that really sticks out in my mind is 1 Thessalonians 5:18. Give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. They both are talking about giving thanks, but they're both talking about it a little bit differently. I read this quote this week that I really think brings those two verses together and brings together what we're going to talk about this morning. It says this, as lilies of the valley pour forth perfume, so good hearts pour forth thanksgiving. No mercy is too small to provoke it, no trial too severe to restrain it. And as Samson got honey from the carcass of the lion that he slew, and as Moses got water from the rock, so the pure in heart are possessed as a sort of heavenly alchemy and a divine secret by which they get blessing out of all things. By which they get blessings out of all things. When I think of being thankful, my first thought is I go to Thanksgiving, or I go back to the days when I was younger and my mom would make out of brown grocery sacks, we would make a craft and we'd make a tree of Thanksgiving. And that's what I first think of. But outside of this season, do I think of giving thanks in the same way? Do I think of giving God thanks in everything I do? Is my heart pure enough as in a season of thanksgiving that I give thanks to God all the time? Are we as a church body doing that? I heard a story of a rich man who killed himself because he feared he might become poor. Rich man killed himself because he was afraid he was going to be poor. But as Jesus has taught us, man's life is not about what he possesses. It's not about the money he has in his account. It's not about the size house he is or the type of furniture that is in his house. Man's real riches lie with his relationship with Jesus. As we look at Thanksgiving, being thankful, I want to ask a question here. And I'm guilty of this too, and so you don't have to answer this out loud if you don't want to, but how often is it that in our lives, when we're in this season of Thanksgiving, how often are we thanking God for the possessions in our lives? Versus how often are we thanking God for the spiritual blessings that we have in our life? It's really easy to say, God, thank you for my house. God, thank you for my car. God, thank you for the money in my bank account. Thank you for my big screen TV. Thank you for football on it. There's a list, and it's so easy to go down the list and to thank God for all the possessions that we have in our lives. But how often are we stopping and thanking God for the spiritual blessings He's given us? Thank you, God, for teaching me patience today. Thank you, God, for allowing me the chance to serve today. Thank you, God, for teaching me what you wanted to today. Thank you, God, for an opportunity I had to share the gospel with somebody. If you're like me, the ratio is a little bit embarrassing. It's a little bit embarrassing. Because it's so easy to be thankful, to give thanks for the things that are easy to give thanks for. Sometimes it's hard to give thanks for the spiritual blessings that God has given us. Sometimes it's hard to sit there and say, thank you, God, for teaching me patience. If any of you were around before service, about 10 minutes before service, Noah was doing a lap from there to there to there and around the steps and down and up and screaming at the top of his lungs. To say that I'm taught patience every day is an understatement. I'm sure we all have stories on that, but at the end of the day, sometimes it's hard for me to say, God, thank you for teaching me patience, when I'm just thankful that my child finally laid down so I have 5 minutes of peace. We've all been there. We've all been there. Sometimes it's hard when God is teaching us and God is working within us in sometimes a painful way. Sometimes it's hard to give thanks in those situations. But should we? Absolutely. Absolutely we should. We should have a thankful heart for everything that is in our lives. Everything. Including the trials in our lives. How often have we sat there and said, thank you, God, for the flat tire I just got? Having a flat tire is a very big inconvenience to our day, right? When we have a flat tire, we have to call somebody or we have to change it to the donut. Then we have to go to the tire shop. We have to have them put a tire on it. Then we have to have it put on. And that just drained an hour and a half or 2 hours out of our day. How often do we say, thank you, God, for the water leak in my house? I can promise you that when I was redoing my house, I did not say thank you once for the water leaks. I can confess that I did not do that. But how often are the trials in our lives, the things that we deal with, the things that make us so mad that maybe we can't see straight, so frustrated that we don't know what to do, how often do we thank God in those times? How often do we have a spirit of thankfulness every time we see God at work, whether we would define it as good or bad? How often do we thank God in all of those situations? And I think that's a question that we have to answer for ourselves. Now, my follow-up on this is, I want you all to know that if your heart is not there, if your thankfulness is not there, that doesn't mean that we're bad people. That doesn't mean we're bad Christians. That's not what I'm saying here. But what I am saying is that the Holy Spirit, as it's working within us, the Holy Spirit, as it's moving, and as we were reminded of thankfulness, it reminds us to let God work in us in this way. This season, if we allow God to work in our hearts and our minds, we can become a thankful people, not just in the month of November, not just when we're sitting down with our families to eat dinner, not just when things are going good and things are going well, but in every situation, we can be thankful. We can be thankful. We can be thankful for all kinds of different situations in our lives. I've talked about it before, and I will during Thanksgiving, and I will talk about it again. If you guys have not had the chance to read Corrie Ten Boom's autobiography, then you need to do that. But she tells a story in her books of when she was in a concentration camp, being thankful for the lice and for the bugs in the dorms. She was thankful for them because the guards would not come in and search and take away their Bibles. They wouldn't come in and stop them from worshiping God. And she was the only one out of her group of women there that could see the blessing in having lice and having bugs. But it just took a little bit of time, and one woman turned and was able to lead multiple women to a relationship with Jesus Christ, all because they were overrun with lice and with bugs. All of a sudden, our situation doesn't seem so bad, does it? In this time of Thanksgiving, I want us to allow ourselves to open up and let God work. Let God make us a thankful people. Let God renew that spirit of thankfulness in our lives. Because we have it good, don't we? We have a lot to be thankful for in the good, but we also have a lot to be thankful for in how God is working in us. Even though it's a challenge, even though it's a struggle, even though there's some days where you walk in the door of your house and you're so frustrated that you don't know what you can do, you can stop and you can thank God for another day that He has been able to teach you a lesson, that He's been able to grow your faith. He has been able to allow you to grow closer to Him that day. This doesn't sound like a logical thing to do, but it's what scripturally we're called to do. We are called scripturally to be a thankful people, to be a people that are grateful for everything that God has given us, what we would classify as good and bad. In our sinful ways, we classify things that God gives us as bad. So let's work this Thanksgiving season. Let's work and work diligently to become a thankful people with a thankful heart. Let's go to God in prayer. Father God, we are so grateful. We are so grateful for the sacrifice of Jesus, and we're so grateful for this time of year that reminds us to be thankful. But God, as we go through this season, as we go through these next few weeks, Father, help us as individuals, help us to refocus. Help us to refocus on what giving thanks means. Help us to refocus on how we can grow closer to you, how our hearts can be opened to giving you the thanks that you deserve. Father, as we continue worshiping and as we get ready to leave this place this morning, Father, I ask that you would touch each of our lives and that you would reveal how we need to open up to you, Father. We thank you for your love and for your grace, and it is in your Son Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. As we prepare for our hymn of invitation, it is Sweet By and By. If you have a decision to make, then this is the time to come forward, or if you need prayer, then this is the time to come forward. If not, then just stay where you are and worship God. So let's stand as we sing 878, Sweet By and By. We have quite a few announcements, so if you would like to sit down for a minute, you can, but you need to leave your ears on, okay? We good? Okay. A lot of things happening in the life of the church in upcoming weeks that I wanted to go ahead and tell you guys about. Number one, I want to remind you, this week is National Shoebox Collection Week. At VCC, we are a drop-off location, so other churches bring their shoeboxes here, and a week from tomorrow, we will be taking them to the regional drop-off center. So there will be a lot of shoeboxes around. Things might look a little different down in the gym, downstairs in the basement, and there will be some banners up out front. So just want to remind you of that. There are sign-up sheets to work different shifts to greet the people that are bringing shoeboxes in and just to be able to help out. That sign-up sheet is down in the foyer, and there are still some slots that are available on there. So if you'd like to do that, we would love to have you a part of the volunteer team for that. Sign-up sheets for the upcoming dinner. It's what? So there's one in the foyer and there's one by this door here. So make sure that you sign up for the upcoming dinner. Deacons are handling the meat. Chicken and ham. That sounds like a good meal to me. So that is coming up, and it is in our bulletin there. It is on December 3rd. December 3rd. So it's in your bulletin as well. I will not repeat what Jeff just said because, okay, Jeff, we'll split it, okay? All right. All right, so make note of that. Please be, please make sure that you make a note of that. Angie.
Because of Shoebox Week, we won't be having support group this Tuesday.
Okay. So support group is canceled Tuesday evening because there's going to be a lot of things going on at the church, but it will resume the following week. So just make a note of that for anybody who is a part of support group. I feel like I'm missing. Oh, yes. Make a note. We have the joint service between us and Driftwood, our Thanksgiving service, will be next Sunday, the 19th, at 6 o'clock. We talked with Driftwood, and we have changed the time to 6 o'clock, and it will be here at Valonia. So make sure to make a note of that time change as well. Yes, finger foods afterwards, yes. So make sure to plan on coming and then also fellowshipping afterwards. So please make notes to attend that. Choir practice Wednesday. Sandy? Perfect. He slipped out because he knew you were going to announce it.
And then, more important note, praise the Lord, out of the 97 residents, we've already had sponsors for 48 for their Christmas, but if you wish to support, be a sponsor, let Barb or Sherry or myself know. We're still collecting for the other 48 residents.
Awesome. Awesome. So, any Bob? I'm so. Good team effort there. We appreciate that. Are there any other announcements? Okay. We will have closing prayer and closing song, but please stay in your seats afterwards. Larry and some of the deacons have something to talk to us about, so it'll be a very impromptu 5-minute meeting following closing song. So if everybody would stand, we will have our closing prayer and we'll sing our closing song. Father God, we are so grateful that we've been able to be in your house and worship this morning. We're so grateful for all of our brothers and sisters here that we were able to worship with. Father, as we depart from this place, I ask that you would put a hedge of protection around each and every one of us, that we will withstand whatever Satan will throw our way this week, and that we will be able to come back here next Sunday ready to be refreshed and renewed in your spirit. Father, protect us and provide for us this week as only you can. We thank you for all that you do, Father, and it's in your Son, Jesus' name, we pray. Amen.